In this lecture, we take our discourse on the constitutional vision and insights into a different level of resource governance. The constitutional facilitation of environment and natural resource management at the grassroots level is the focus of attention for us in this session. As you could see on the screen, the vision and the direction that the Constitution gives for an intervention which is not statist alone, but it is at a lower level, at the grassroots level. It is governance from the grassroots. There are three dimensions to this inquiry here. One is the communitarian management. The second one is decentralized governance. And the third one, the communitarian engagement, participation and involvement in resource management, not necessarily holding the reins of control or power, either through a statutory information or a recognition of some practice which has been there since time immemorial, and the statute and the administration has no objection for its continuation. This actually brings to the fore the idea that we saw in the 42nd Amendment of the Constitution in the form of a fundamental duty of a citizen of being an environmental steward. This environmental stewardship concept, I reiterate here, has very much been an integral aspect of our constitutional system of governance long before the 42nd Amendment came, right from the day the Constitution was inaugurated 25 years earlier to the 42nd Amendment. Let us get into the details of it. The first aspect, the communitarian control and management. Autonomy in governance is what is being contemplated. There are elaborate provisions made for bringing in communities of people into the mainstream of resource governance. And this is essentially based upon the basic idea at the inauguration of our constitution, that there is one section of Indian community who are not in the mainstream, but who have been living a particular way of life, who are predominantly tribal, and these areas, which has a very significant tribal presence, has a distinctive social milieu, has a distinctive political organization, has a distinctively different approach to resource governance. And it was a policy decision on the part of Government of India, reflected through these set of provisions under the Constitution, to enable, facilitate, and ensure that particular way of life would continue and would become part of the larger picture of resource governance at various levels, including at the level of the community of people. This is what you do see in those areas which are described as Schedule 5 and Schedule 6 areas under the Constitution. These areas are very clearly laid out, right, predominantly in the northeastern region of India, and in the rest of India, wherever in those areas where you have a significant presence of the tribal population, more than 50% or so, in which event these are carved out for special administration. Administration by whom? By the community themselves. So you have that relevant provision, section article 244 refers to that. And the very important feature of this is that not only they do have their kind of organization put into application, irrespective of the other kind of organization of the general administration, the bureaucracy that you have, the revenue department, so many other departments of the government. Quite unlike that, a specialized administrative setup. You have something called the tribal council, and you have a particular practice of these communities of people in the administrative setup, integrated into the whole scheme of governance by them. So much so that even the law that is made either at the state level or at the central level, in order that that should be made applicable in these regions, care should be taken to ensure that in these Schedule 5 and Schedule 6 areas, that these rules and regulations that we have made, which has a pan-India significance, can be applied in these areas only after ensuring their compatibility with the local customs, traditions and practices of communities of people living there. It's almost like a litmus test. You have enacted some law which is perfect for the rest of India, but for these regions, whether it would be in consonance with the cultural values, mores and practices of these people, and if it is so, adopt them. In fact, the governor of each and every state has been entrusted with that responsibility of making sure that kind of an alignment with the practice of these communities with that of the rest of India, so as to internalize the national and state laws at the domestic, at the local level for these communities. So these areas are so structured and designed, and the schemes of governance is worked out in such a way as to ensure a very high degree of autonomy for the people in accessing the resources, in managing the resources, in having control over the local natural resources. In the year 1996, the government of India came up with what was referred to as Panchayat Extension to Scheduled Areas Act. You know, following the 73rd and 74th Amendment to the Constitution, at the local level, especially in the rural areas, the Panchayat Raj Law came into existence. And by and large, these tribal areas are rural. And so the question was whether the Panchayat Raj Law would extend to them as well, more by way of a clarification, and also as a kind of a mechanism. This new law was made, acronymed as PESA, P-E-S-A, 1996, Panchayat Extension to Scheduled Areas Act. It makes it very clear that if a Panchayat Raj law of having the same Gram Panchayat, Taluk Panchayat and District Panchayat, with a Gram Sabha as the General Assembly, which is actually the political composition of that entire outfit with regard to the Panchayat, if it is to translate into application at the local level, the question that should be foremost on the part of the state government is to see whether this kind of an administrative structure is in line with what is being practiced by these people, what is in vogue amongst these people. If that is so, go ahead. Otherwise, no way. The level of autonomy of these people at any cost should be retained. Of course, the national law concerning criminal law, without an exception, is applicable everywhere, including in these scheduled areas. So it is nothing like these people are a law unto themselves. But in order to meet their day-to-day requirements, in order to continue with their cultural traditions and practices, there shall not be any hindrance or intervention, and the autonomy of these people should be respected. And to that extent, this particular set of provisions are made under the Constitution. So you manage your own resources, you have your own administrative setup, you have a political organization of your own kind, and that will take care of your resources. So you become the masters of your own destiny. And you don't have to look up to a governmental agency to work out certain plans and programs and implement them for your betterment or well-being. You will take care of your own well-being because you know the best as to how to handle your own lives, your own resources, because you are perfectly in tune with the rest of nature. And in recognition of that, these constitutional provisions are made. If you actually take a scan of all those conservation areas that we have in India, what is being described as heritage conservation sites of international significance and importance, a large number of them, a large majority of them are there in these areas, which has a very deep ecological and spiritual significance, that their perfect symbiosis with the rest of nature as a part of their life and they being part of the rest of the environment is manifest in the upkeep, maintenance and management of these heritage sites which populate these areas in a far more significant number than what you have in the rest of India. A testimony to their environment friendly way of life recognized through the constitutional scheme. The second dimension, as has been facilitated under the Constitution through the 73rd and 74th Amendment that occurred in the year 1992, of making the local communities as not just the participants but partners in a system of governance, and that is decentralized governance of resources. This happens through this 73rd and 74th Amendment of the Constitution. The 73rd Amendment is for the rural local bodies in the form of Gram Panchayat or the Village Panchayat, Taluk Panchayat and Panchayat at the district level, the Panchayat Raj system. The 74th Amendment ushers in the grassroots governance at the urban level in the case of municipalities and municipal corporations, Nagarpalikas and Nagar Sabhas. And legislations have come into existence to give effect to these two amendments to make the local government a self-governing area as far as the resources are concerned, their management is concerned, planning to use those resources to be generated from their end and worked by them. Schedules 10 and 11 lists out all those subjects that come under this particular category for governance at the local level by the local self-government institutions. It is truly a democratic decentralization of governance to the third tier of governance under the constitutional scheme. So in a manner of speaking, the local government has been elevated to the status of the third tier of governance under the constitutional scheme after the center at the apex, the state at the middle level, and at the local level, the local bodies, the panchayats and urban local bodies being made the seat of governance at the local level. While the center and states have, of course, the exclusive power of making a law, so municipalities and municipal corporations at the urban level, the panchayats at the rural level, they cannot make a law. They cannot create a statute. The statute is the prerogative of being made at the state or at the central legislative level. So either the parliament or the state legislatures make these laws. But when it comes to the governance or management, administration of those resources at the local level, That is what is being handed over to or transferred to the local government by the state government. I had mentioned earlier, if you have very carefully followed what has been mentioned earlier, even those laws that are made at the central level concerning natural resources, they are administered at the state level. And we go to the third level now, that in terms of administration, on issues which are purely local, which are listed out in the 10th and 11th schedule of the Constitution, the panchayats and the urban local bodies do administer them. And what are those subjects? Just to give a few examples, public health, hygiene, sanitation, maintenance of drainage systems, community assets like ponds and water bodies, pasture lands, public amenities like public conveniences, public parks, public places of recreation, all would figure under the system of governance by the urban and local, rural local bodies, under the head urban and rural commons. Here, just to reiterate this position, that this is what the constitution makers meant. And this is an ordained duty of the local bodies to take care of the local resources without any hindrance at one level, without any excuse at another level. That means you have the right to govern, you also have a duty not to shirk away from that responsibility. Shirking away from that responsibility is unconstitutional. Who says this? The highest court of law clarified this position in a landmark judgment delivered by the Supreme Court. The case is Ratlam Municipality versus Vardichan. It's a 1980 decision of the Supreme Court. Like it happens in most of the urban areas, the sanitary system was in very bad shape in that municipality called Ratlam in Madhya Pradesh. There was no proper maintenance of the drainage system. The sewerage system was in shambles. There was no upkeep, there was no maintenance, and there was stench all around. An action was initiated at the local court and at the state high court at the second level, questioning inaction on the part of the local administration in not properly maintaining and managing these civic amenities. And it is going to be a health hazard if these are not taken care of. The High Court made it very clear that this is a duty of the local bodies to take care, and they should ensure that these are the functions that they should not really shirk away from. It is written in the law, it is written in the statute under which they are created, the municipality regulations or the municipal corporations. They have an ordained duty to perform these functions, and non-maintenance of it is inexcusable. The matter went to the Supreme Court. The municipalities challenged, how could we do that when we have very few people to work, we have shortage of funds, we have budgetary constraints, and we have so much of difficulties. You do not understand our difficulties. As and when we get this, we will be able to take care of that. So till then, you need have to manage with whatever we do, that kind of attitude. And that got reflected in the kind of argumentation they presented before the Supreme Court of India. Justice V.R. Krishnayar, who delivered the judgment on behalf of the Supreme Court of India, made it very clear that these provisions of construction of, maintenance of, repair and management of these basic civic public amenities, the drainage system, the sewage system, are mandatory functions to be performed by the local bodies. These functions can never ever be delegated to anyone, nor for that matter be ignored. There can neither be a negligence nor an ignorance, nor inaction. All your arguments as to constraints or budgets or anything will not hold water. This is a non-negotiable function that you have to perform. This is a duty that you have to discharge. Your very existence as an authority is to discharge this primary, inalienable, non-negotiable function of yours. You have to perform this duty. Budgetary constraints are no excuse. Perform this, and there can be budgetary constraints for other things, like certain kinds of facilities that should be provided for the authorities in performing their functions. The vehicles, a fleet of vehicles that you would acquire, you can keep it on hold. Make provision for this first and then look to taking care of this requirement, and then you can take care of other things if funds are available. So budgetary constraints are no excuse. In a way, it is actually the reiteration of the constitutional spirit of governance, that the local bodies are the managers of the local environment at the primary level. The state and the center will come at the secondary and at the tertiary level. And local resources need to be managed locally. And for that purpose, these bodies are created. A wonderful clarification, if at all there was any such thing that was required, because that's what the administration thought, that this is not something that could be imposed on them. And what the court made it clear, it's nothing like an imposition. It is a basic duty that you owe. And your very existence and effectiveness of your functioning is dependent on that. You owe your existence for performing this particular kind of function. Then the next aspect, as to what happened with the 73rd and 74th amendments to the Constitution and the creation of the 10th and 11th schedules. I did mention that this actually led to democratic decentralization of governance. Was governance centralized? By and large, yes. Till this happened in 1992, the role and responsibility of the local bodies in the form of the Panchayat Raj was very much like a subordinate entity in carrying those exercises as per the dictation and direction of the state government. The direction and dictation of the state government would continue, but this would be subject to one thing, and that is many of the subjects which the states were actually administering themselves are being transferred. From this, we move on to the third dimension of taking governance of natural resources to the grassroots of the local level, and that is communitarian engagement. There is a provision under the Constitution, Article 372, which makes it very clear that all the laws in force that are immediately before the commencement of the Constitution will continue to operate, and they are recognized as the laws of the land, and they get renewed. Even with the inauguration of the Constitution, they are not put to an end. And these laws are not confined to statutes that are formulated or acts or legislations that have come from the state, but they also extend to customs and traditions of the communities of people. So customs, having the force of law, has been brought to the forefront here when you refer to Article 372, and this has been clarified by a judgment that was delivered in the year 1992. It's the case of In Re Amina, wherein even customs and traditions would continue to operate, and it is not confined to only statutes that were formulated during the British period. Because customs and traditions They spring from the practices of communities of people over a long period of time, and we need to have to recognize that. Resource management by the people who are living closest to that particular resource is the normal, general, common practice of the people. And this has been there since time immemorial, and we will not disrupt this particular kind of a practice. All that you need have to state and establish is whether there has been such a practice. We will continue that. Till such time, these are overtaken by any statute that the legislature chooses to make. But if it doesn't, and if it doesn't really bother about that, then the communities can continue to manage their local water bodies, their sacred groves, or whatever that are there in these areas. So there is a constitutional recognition of traditions and practices concerning resource management by the people. They are described as common property. They are described as community property. They are referred to as community assets. If you look to the 10th schedule of the Constitution, this is one of the subjects that has been mentioned there, that the community assets, so there is a recognition that community have assets of their own, and it is not the state property, it is a communitarian property, and this communitarian property can be managed by the community themselves if there is no statutory prescription excluding them from such a kind of a management. So property over which a group of people have a common interest of taking care, of protection, of conservation, of deriving benefits therefrom, to a set of practices that they have, they can continue to practice the same, and there is a constitutional protection for the same. So, the only condition that is laid down for these customary practices to continue is that these practices should not be opposed to public policy, should not be opposed to public health, should not be opposed to public morality. All customs and traditions will continue to operate, and they will have the force of law. But who determines that these customs and traditions are environment friendly? These customs and traditions are not opposed to any of the public values and practices which are recognized as something which is a great ideal or a value to be practiced by the people? Well, the ultimate decision maker in this regard is the courts of law. Should you have a doubt, and should there be a dispute between the state agency and these communities of people, the matter can always be taken to the court, and the court will lay down the final law, the land on the point, and in accordance with that, you need to resolve the conflict. Which is the other way of saying that the state administration and the state legislature, unless and until it is very clear that a customary practice with regard to a particular resource is against sustainable, environmentally sustainable management of the resources or anything like that. And having decided that way, comes up with a very clear statutory formulation to that effect. Till that time, the practice of the people would continue, and the community continue to control and manage these resources. I'm just giving you a few illustrative examples as to how either a particular practice is allowed to continue even after the inauguration of our constitution, even to this day, or even when statutes are made in relation to that, sufficient provisions are made as an exceptional provision for allowing the communities to continue to adopt and practice and perpetuate the practice that they have. One is the practice with regard to what is referred to as one panchayat system. Even during the British period, in the then United Province, which later became Uttar Pradesh in independent India, Now, it is Uttarakhand region. In that region, the British recognized the communitarian symbiotic relationship with the forest area that they were living in, of its management, of its upkeep and maintenance by the community themselves and not by the forest department at all. They created a new law called the One Panchayat Act in 1930, permitting and now legally approving the community to continue to manage those resources, and a statutory recognition was given to the communitarian practice way back in 1930 by the British. The same continued even after independence till around 1970s. This got absorbed in the forest rules under the Uttar Pradesh Forest Act. The second example I can give you is a particular practice in the western part of India, Maharashtra, in Gadchiroli, Mandaleka area, called the Nistar practice. It is a traditional practice of the communities there, tribal communities there, over certain forest produce. It's a practice of deriving benefit from those forest produce, which for their livelihood and for their day-to-day life, they were accessing and using it for themselves. And this, along with the cultivation practices that they had, was described as a Nistar practice. Nistar. And this got legal recognition under the Forest Rights Act enacted in the year 2006 by Government of India, and even under the rules that has been framed and followed in Maharashtra, this has been recognized now. The third one, in the very same state, Maharashtra, there is another system where the community themselves managing the water bodies and water resources for a wide variety of purposes, referred to as the Pani Panchayat system. Pani, water, Panchayat, a group of community leadership which would take care of the management of the water that is available at the local level. And this practice has been recognized and internalized in the Maharashtra water laws now. So to sum up, the constitutional scheme of resource and environmental management presents an ideal management model for the rest of the world to emulate. Think globally and act locally. Action at the local level has been ingrained in the constitutional scheme long, long time back, much before what happened, a kind of a jargon, a slogan at the global level. Think globally and act locally. Local management is the mainstay of governance and recognized under the constitutional scheme, and makes the government, the center of the state government, as more of a public trustee rather than as the owner of resources. Considers individuals and communities as environmental stewards. It accords in a constitutional status very much like the center and the state government to the local government institutions to administer, maintain and manage local resources. Look at the scheme that has been evolved by involving and engaging these communities so as to work out amongst themselves, as to apportioning the benefits amongst themselves, to prevent discrimination amongst them. An element of equity has been read into the working of this scheme of governance here, for the benefit of the community, derived by the public at large, the communities by themselves. It recognizes community as a common property over which the members of the community would have a co-equal use right. It creates autonomous regions. The constitution confers powers of a state on communities of people in certain tribal and scheduled areas to manage the local resources and politically organize themselves to govern their own resources. What a model that we have. It is such a wonderful model of governance where you have the center, the state, the local bodies and the local communities managing the resources that has been worked out in the whole scheme of environmental governance. The next session would invariably focus on, in a more interactive way, as to whether there is something called as a right to environment recognized under the constitutional scheme. That is in the next session.